talking about living for God even when we don't see Him moving, even we don't feel Him, and there's many times we don't hear God. And we pray and we wonder, why God? Well, I can't hear you. And the first thing we've got to check, like I said last week, is ourselves. Amen. But if we check ourselves, make sure we're right, we're not hearing from God, don't panic. Because that doesn't mean God is not moving. It just means that we're going through a time and a period. And I know myself, when I'm not feeling good, when I'm sick or I'm tired or physically, I'm not as discerning spiritually, if I can say it like that. But like after like last night, the extra hour of rest we had, amen, you know, wow. But the part that as the Lord moved us through Scripture down a path that seemed to really resonate with us, and the amazing part was the word we heard was not filled with the type of teaching or preaching, whatever you want to, I did, but it causes an outward expression like it did. That's not normal. It was, you know, you get these services where the preacher's preaching, you know, you're jumping, but the teaching was kind of anti-jump, yet the response when the presence of God settled it, you see, it doesn't matter what the word is, our response must be the same. Because Lord might want us to learn something hard, like steak. He's not always going to give us milk and cream corn. Sometimes He's going to give us some roast beef and tough stuff and steak where you have to chew it and you've got to get the best part out of it. And so we're so thankful for God. And we spoke last week of the need for faith. And the thing about faith is it manifests itself when we're not operating on experience. I'm the type of person, I'm going to be honest with you, I don't like change. I don't like the time change. I don't like when my boss calls me and says, you got a new kid on your bus, so you got to do this different, or some change. I don't like changes. I'm stubborn. I'm not stubborn. I like to stay in my ways. But faith does not operate when we operate in experience and what we know. Faith steps in when we get out of our comfort zone, out of our expected zone and experience zone. That's when faith rises. What, like we read in Hebrews chapter 1, faith is the substance of things hoped for. It's the evidence of things not seen. And this is how the elders obtained a good report. They didn't get the good report because of their success. They got their good report because they kept to the task. Amen, by faith. And if you have the experience or the things hoped for, you don't need faith.
That's right.
That makes sense.
If you get everything you want, you don't have to hope for anything. You don't need the faith because you already reached. If you can go to the store and buy a gallon of milk, if you're going to buy a gallon of milk, you don't need faith. You go to the store and you buy your milk. But if you don't have any money, you're going to need some faith to pray, Lord, I need. And that's a problem in North America. We have it too cushy, too easy. Because if we lose our jobs, we've got CERB, we got unemployment, we got welfare, we got social assistance, we got people with a lot of money, we got people on the street that we can go steal from.
That's true.
I'm not saying we're going to, but that's where our society is. There's a lack of faith because people are not learning to trust in God. We also took apart Peter's writing to the church, and like I said, not the well-established church, not the everything going for them church, but the church that was scattered and suffered much, a persecuted church, had lost so much, including their homes and maybe even their identity because they're not part of the big church downtown. A tired church that may or may not have known which way to turn, but just putting one foot in front of the other. You know what it's like at times when you hear reports, you know, especially down south, you know, so many people receiving the Holy Ghost and 15 people baptized, and we're struggling here, maybe to see one person baptized. But we're just putting one foot in front of the other. And so this is the church that Peter was writing to, and he wasn't calling them the elect because of all their success. He was calling them the elect because they stood to the task. Amen. That they were still serving God, because of their knowledge of Jesus, their relationship. And, amen. They knew him as Paul had wrote about, not just in the resurrection power, but also in the suffering. Amen. Some being made conformable even to his death. And there was a lot of people, amen, in that time period that lost their life for Christianity. Yeah. We haven't seen that yet. We haven't seen, like I said before, we get mad when somebody throws a tomato at the church or leaves a beer bottle on the lawn, and no respect. We haven't seen persecution. I don't want to see it. But these people were hanging on in spite of what was against them. They're called the elect. And if our incredible God, and that's what we're talking about this year, if our incredible God was there for them at that time, in that day, in their suffering, surely that same incredible God is going to be with us, amen, in our church and our life. Because remember, the church is not this building. It's not this address. You and I have become the church. Right. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 19, Paul was writing, and he said, "Now therefore you are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God. And you're built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ being the chief cornerstone, in whom all the building fitly framed together groweth unto a holy temple to the Lord." I remember the last service, I believe it was the last service that I preached in the Philippines, and the host pastor drove me around to 18 or 19 different churches that 3 weeks that were there, and we preached, and I preached on angels. On the Sunday morning in his home church, and I said, people flock to see angels. They read books about seeing angels, and they hunger to see angels. And I said to them, I said, if you want to see an angel, here's your pastor. Because the book of Revelation talks about the pastor being the angel of the city. Well, here, people in North America and around the world will go to Jerusalem to see the temple. And they spend a lot of money and time and effort to go to Jerusalem to see the temple, because that was the temple of God. Amen. And in the Old Testament, they had the temple, and people, that was their central point. Everything pointed towards the temple. Now, folks, I'm not against going to Israel and Jerusalem and all that. I'm not against travel at all. But if you want to see the temple, you don't need to go to Jerusalem, because you have become the temple. You have become the temple of the living God. That's what Paul was saying. You have become the temple of the living God. And when you look at your brothers and sisters, don't look at their weak points, don't look at their mistakes, but look at them. They are the temple of the living God. When you get discouraged, amen, and tired and worn out, look in the mirror and don't see how you failed, God, but tell yourself, I am the temple. Shalamakaya. Tell yourself that I have become the temple of the living God, and I am the temple of the Holy One, and God chose to dwell inside of me. I don't need a Mecca. I don't need a building. I am the household now of God. I, as Paul said, am no longer a foreigner or stranger to the saint. I've become a saint of God. I've become the temple of the living God. God does not, and he is not interested in abiding or living, amen, in statues or buildings or any other inanimate object. He chooses to live in his people, and his people only. Those people are going to churches and they're going to edifices, and they think God is there because of the building or the statue. God is not there because of the building or the statue. God is in his people. And I'm going to say this again. God is going to be in his people. Right. Not just any people. Yeah. He's not going to go into the Philistines. They're Philistines. He is not going to go into the Amorites because they're not God's people. Now, if they would convert in the Old Testament to Judaism, he would. He would be their God. And if we want to, amen, take that analogy, amen, God is not choosing the world to live in. He's choosing his people.
That's right.
And who's his people? Those that obey him. Come on.
Amen.
John 14 and verse 6. And I know we're not going to get done again. I know it. Jesus said unto him, I am the way, the truth, the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. You cannot get into heaven, amen, if you want to believe that God is sitting up in heaven and he's not Jesus Christ, and that's false doctrine. But if you want to go there, you can't get there unless you go through Jesus.
That's right.
And the only way you can get through Jesus, he told his apostles, tell them this, to repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus for the remission of sin. Because sin can't get to heaven. John 15, verse 4, Jesus said, abide in me and I in you, as a branch cannot bear fruit of itself except it abide in the vine, no more can you except you abide in me. It does not matter, and I'm going to say this plain as day, it does not matter what anybody or any organization or any church or any spiritual advisor, I don't care how many books they've written, I don't care how many podcasts they have, I don't care how many YouTube videos they have, I don't care about all that. I don't care what university they went to, I don't care what Bible college they went to, amen, if they teach or preach anything other than the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Bible says they are going to be accursed.
Amen.
Amen. It doesn't matter what they say, we need to abide in Jesus, and he needs to abide in us. And if I want to be the temple, and here's where the rubber meets the road, folks, stop bringing prayer requests for family and different people around us if we're not going to live for God ourselves.
Right.
Amen.
Oh, Pastor, where are you going? You see, we talk. Oh, I talk to my neighbor, and they're hungry, but they're not hungry. Amen. Because of you, they're hungry, and you better show them Christ in you.
That's right. Give them the right.
Because we can pray all we want, and if you're not setting an example for them, our prayers are I'm not saying they're useless, but they're being defeated.
Yeah. Oh, my God.
Mm-hmm. I am. I know it might be a hard saying. I know it might be hard in your ears. Amen. I understand that. But we've got to talk about a promise and a fulfillment of promise. Amen. If I abide in him, he is going to abide in me. It's my responsibility to make sure. Everybody say make sure.
Make sure.
To make sure that we're living in him. Again, on the day of Pentecost, Peter preached to the Jewish onlooker, and he said, there's a promise, but before the promise can come, and everybody wants a promise. Everybody wants a miracle. Everybody wants the answer. But before the answer came, the instructions came, and again, he said, to repent, be baptized, and then you'll receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. And I understand people receive the Holy Ghost before being baptized. I understand that. I'm not against that. But in general terms, you've got to be hungry for God and live for God so he can fill you with the promise. Here's what Acts 2:38 really said. If you obey the word, everybody say obey the word.
Obey the word.
Jesus would abide in them. That makes sense, doesn't it?
Yeah.
If we... Remember what the scripture, many principles in scripture say we have to do the thing first. If I want Jesus to draw nigh to me, I can't just say, oh, draw nigh to me, God. Oh, I need you. No. I've got to put my first step forward by faith even. And I've got to step closer to him, and then he's going to step closer to me. But if I'm not going to move. See, our society is so messed up. We want to give everything away. And we just want, oh, here, God will bless you. God will take care of you. You don't have to do anything. Just accept Jesus. You know, it's your mighty great act of willfulness to accept the promise. No. See, it's not just accepting. Amen. There's something on our part. Amen. There's something that we have to do. And I know, I understand sometimes it's hard to live for God, but it's a whole lot easier to live for God than living for the world. Because living for the world, as bad as you want to get, you can enjoy yourself. But you know that phrase, you got to pay the piper? There's no promise in the world. They promise nothing. But Jesus said, if you abide in me, I'll abide in you. And really, what Peter was expressing on the day of Pentecost is not a hard saying. Amen. It's a promise, including with a command, if we want to be called the elect. Isn't that a good saying? I am the elect. Think about it. When Peter was talking to the church in general, the scattered church, he called them the elect. Now, if you're going through a hard time, and somebody, come on up here, Dave. I can't come down there because, come on, hurry, run, walk fast. I'll put my mask on. Dave, oh, you look nice, Dave. Dave's going through a hard time. Come on over here. Dave's going through a difficult time, and he's worn out, and he's tired, and he's hunched over, and so much from difficulty and stress. And then somebody comes along and said, Dave, you are the elect. What does that do to your psyche? What does that do to your mind? What does that do to your confidence? Oh, somebody recognizes that I'm going through a hard time, and yet they don't question me. They don't look at me as if I'm some downcast, but I am the elect in their eyes. What does that do? Does that straighten your back and put your shoulders up in the air and put your head high and you walk away a different person because somebody acknowledged that you are part and you are the elect? Thank you, Dave. Amen. There's something about being the elect, but I have to choose. John chapter 1, verse 12. But as many received him, to them he gave he power. Woo. Woo. Somebody go, woo. As many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. Now notice here, it's not just those that received him, but they receive with the believing, amen, in his name. I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe, I'm going to say it again, church, I believe in the name of Jesus. Amen. I'm going to tell you something. I believe in the name, and I believe on the name of Jesus so much that if he tells me to do something, I am going to do it. Why do I do it? Why do I choose? Because I can't see him. Sometimes I can't feel him. Sometimes I can't hear him. But I'm reading my Bible. I'm reading and I'm praying. And I feel something in my heart. And Jesus is telling me. And I believe him so much that I don't have to feel you, God. I believe him so much that I'm going to follow him. Yeah. That's what he's saying here. Not just believe. Anybody can believe in Jesus. And everybody does believe in Jesus. Some believe in him so much that he's just a man. Some believe that he is God manifest in us. Some believe he's the second person in the Trinity. But they still believe him. Yeah. He that believeth on me as the scripture said. Come on. As the scripture has said. Mm-hmm. You see, you can't just believe any old way. I don't know why we're going here. You can't believe any old way, but you've got to follow the scripture. Like I said last week, trials are going to come, and they have come, and they're going to come. Disturbances, tribulations, struggles, and in a couple weeks, we're going to start looking at some of them. They may be to the point where we don't feel like the elect, and they may be to the point we may not feel like we're riding a mountaintop experience with God. But if we have Jesus abiding in us, and we are abiding in him, and whether we feel him or not, whether we know what's going on or not, I'm sorry, you're not going to hear from this pulpit, from this pastor, everything is going to go on in the end times, because I don't know. In my mind, I can tell you this is the out plan. This is how everything's going to take place. But that's just my view. I could be way off. But no matter whether I feel him, hear him, even sense him, I can still stand, amen, no matter what is going on. Now, everybody say now.
Now.
We get to last week's lesson. We're going to continue, or we're going to start what I wanted to start last week. Before we go on, I want to remind everyone what I said last week. If we don't sense God, and I said this morning, we need to make sure we're living right before we can say that, oh, I just can't feel him because I just can't feel him. And maybe God shut the door for a purpose. No, make sure we're living right. Exodus chapter 1, verse 7. The children of Israel were fruitful, and they increased abundantly, and they multiplied, and they waxed exceeding mighty, and the land was filled with them. They're in Egypt. Now there arose up a new king over Egypt that knew not Joseph. And you know the story of Joseph and how he was taken, and his brothers used him bad and turned out to good, and he forgave them. And then the Pharaoh gave him a place and the best land of Egypt and brought his family. You know the whole story. And then taskmasters came and a new king rose up. And he said to his people, behold, the people of the children of Israel are more and they're mightier than us. He said, come on. Let's deal wisely with them, lest they multiply. And it come to pass that when there falleth out any war, they join also against our enemies and fight against us, and so get them up out of the land. Therefore they did set over them taskmasters to afflict them with their burdens, and they built for Pharaoh treasure cities, Pithom and Ramses. But the more they afflicted them, the more they multiplied. And the more they grew, and they were grieved because of the children of Israel. And the Egyptians made the children of Israel to serve with rigor. And they made their lives bitter with hard bondage in mortar, brick, and all manner of service in the field. All their service wherein they made them serve was with rigor. In chapter 3, verse 7, he said, the Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people, which are in Egypt, and have heard their cry by reason of their taskmasters, for I know their sorrows. The children of God were in the land of Egypt. It was a place where God actually sent them. And so we can question, we say, well, why would God send them knowing the outcome? Because the Lord knows the beginning from the ending, right? And we can say, well, God's mean because look what happened. But look what happened before this took place. Amen. Egypt took care of God's people for them. Amen. In time of Joseph, there's no food to survive the famine. And therefore, they survived as a nation because of this. God had ordained that through the life of Joseph that his people would live on. His bloodline would continue. People would not be destroyed. Amen. And his chosen would survive. In fact, they didn't just survive. The Bible says they multiplied. They multiplied and they increased abundantly and they waxed exceedingly mighty. And the land was filled with these people. Wow. So much for suffering, eh? They were having a good time. They were having a revival. They were having an ingathering. We can say that. Because they were just, God was moving on their behalf. And God told Abraham before this, he said, you're going to be a father of a great nation. Your seed will be as the stars of heaven. Your seed will be as the sand of the sea. That's what he told Abraham. And so now God is starting to cause his people to grow and multiply. But for a brief, and even though God promised that his seed will have the land forever, it shall be theirs. He promised them this, amen. But for a brief period in their history, amen, they had to live in Egypt, amen, just to get by. We don't like to wait. We don't like pauses in our life, do we? You see, when we're going forward, whether we're going through something or we're you know, something good or something bad, we're still moving. Yeah. I know I'm just going to bear myself here, my soul here. When I'm in traffic, I will drive around the traffic. I'll take all the side streets and spend more time the side streets than I do the main street that's plugged. But I'm driving. I feel better because I'm moving. I might be cost more. I might be driving further, but I am going forward. But I don't like to stand or sit doing absolutely nothing. And that's a hard place for a church to be. We're not growing. I'm not talking about church-wise. I'm talking individual-wise. We're not growing, but we're not being attacked. And so there's a nothingness. There's a place, a pause. And we begin to wonder, well, God, are you still there? You know, and I mentioned this, and you already know this, but most accidents happen within 5 minutes of home, 5 or 10 minutes. Because you let down your guard. You're not driving with this, not excitement, but this energy, this awareness of, oh, I got to watch where I'm going. I don't want to turn down. But once you get in your home, you know the way. Yeah. So you kind of, oh, relax. And that's when trouble happens, usually. That's another issue. But for a brief period in their time, amen, they had to live in Egypt to get by. They were not to be there forever, amen, just until the famine was over, until they built themselves up a nation to watch themselves be strong enough to be who God wanted them to be. They were not there yet, but God had a plan. You see, God, like I said earlier, the Lord knows the ending from the beginning, and he knows every step in between. We want to jump steps, don't we? We want to go from 0 to 100 miles an hour without accelerating. We just want that quick. We want the victory. We want the miracle. We want the wonder, but we don't want to take the steps involved to get there. There's a problem with that. So, hey, but there's a problem with learning to walk. You've got to crawl. If a person went from being held as a baby to walking, they wouldn't learn how to fall. That's why babies learn to crawl first. It's a process. It's a step. You cannot know advanced math until you go to grade one. Until you know the basics. The same is living for God. And I'm not saying we're at level basics, but every part of our life is a step. And we've got to trust the process. And sometimes that process is when we don't understand what God is doing. Sometimes there's a process where we don't hear the voice of God speaking in whatever language we want to hear him in. Sometimes we're not having the platter put before us. Sometimes, every once in a while, God bless my wife, but every once in a while, I got to get my own dinner. Big deal. Well, the same process with God. Sometimes I've got to do some work. And I don't feel him. And I don't feel that anointing. Why? Because I got to do the work. Now watch this. The Egyptians, look at their thinking process. They thought if Israel grew and multiplied as they were, they were going to overtake the Egyptians. The Jews had no plan of overtaking the Egyptians. They were grateful for what they had. Hey, amen. Without their notice, Egypt became afraid. Now, I want you to understand this. Without the children of God taking notice, Egypt became afraid of them. They put up a front. Hey, but this is what happened. Egypt put up this facade, this front, this fakeness. Hey, man, they began to afflict the people, not because they're hard taskmasters, because they were afraid. They made them labor. They made them making everything harder. They made their life bitter in bondage. They whipped them and beat them and killed them. It's not necessarily a scenario of fear, yet the Egyptians were fearful of the children of God. Now behind the scenes, let's go behind the curtain here. Amen. Behind the curtain, amen, the Lord was still at work. And I'm sure the children of God didn't feel, amen, as they're working in rigor, they didn't feel the presence of God, the aura of God. They didn't feel the power of God. And they didn't sense God was on their side. All they had to do and all they did was work, 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 work. And they multiplied abundantly and greatly, and they became a great people. Amen. So behind the scenes, God was at work. The burning bush with Moses was awaiting them. Amen. Moses in Pharaoh's house, amen, finding favor with them, amen, was ahead of them. Moses, amen, leaving Egypt, amen, and getting direction from God. Israel, the children of God, didn't know this. But God knew exactly what was going on. It was no surprise to God that Egypt started belittling and beating and tormenting his people. Exodus chapter 2, verse 24. God heard their groaning, and God remembered his promise with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And God looked upon the children of Israel, and God had respect unto them. In other words, he realized that, hey man, I know what you're going through. There's times when you fall to your knees and you begin to pray and you begin to moan and groan in the Holy Ghost and you don't know the answer and the walls are closing in on you and you don't know where to turn. Behind the scenes, God knows exactly what is going on. And like he did with his people, he has respect. He understands what you're going through. Even though the children of Israel were in a very rough place, a very rough time in their generation, in their lives, when things got too tough to handle, amen, too tough to bear, when they could no longer see the hand of God, amen, moving in their lives, and when they got to the place of despair, amen, when they got to the place where they couldn't make it anymore, guess what happened? We begin to read how God says, I heard their groanings, I understand what they're going through, and I'm going to begin a process to escape them from the trouble. When you think, now remember, we're gonna preface this next statement with, as long as we're living right for God. Because I don't want people using this as an excuse either. When we're living for God as we should be living for God, and I'm not saying how you think you should, how you know you should.
That's right.
Okay, there's a big difference. And you think you can't make it anymore. Amen. And you think you cannot survive anymore. And you think that God is, things are just getting too much for you. God has different plans. Behind the scenes, as his children, God was working. Amen. In all their needs and frustrations, he began to work on their behalf. I can't tell you what they felt. I can't tell you what they sensed. But I can put myself in their shoes and say, I would not feel God. Let's be honest. Amen. We've all gone through hard times. And you tell me when you've been on your knees and struggled and the weight bearing down on your shoulder and you sort of say, I feel God moving. Very unlikely. Come on, folks. You know what I'm talking about? Am I just talking about my own experience? You don't feel God. You don't sense God. You're not getting direction from God. You think God is mad at you. You think God has left you. Forsaking you. Come on. Anybody there? How many times? I don't like to ask this question, but I'm going to. How many read their Bibles through in a year? Through Bible reading every
year.
I'm not going to ask how many times. But how many times have you read the scripture? How many times have you heard the scripture? How many times have you thought of the scripture when the Lord says, I will never leave nor forsake you? How many times has the concept of God come through to your spirit said, I will be your God and you shall be my people. See, these are not statements and scriptures for the elite. Those are not there when you're wondering what mountain you're going to jump on today. They're not for the time when you can sit back on the clouds and say, ooh, this is nice. Those scriptures are there for when you're in rubbing your belly on the floor. How many times have you read where the Lord said, I will be your strong tower? Mm-hmm. How many times have you sung the song, amen, about how he's going to be your refuge? What did David say? He encouraged himself singing in the word and praying, and we can pray in the spirit. And you start praying. When we're going through a hard time, you know what our prayer is? Oh, God, help me. Oh, God, I'm going through a hard time. Deliver me. Well, what about changing your prayer? Lord, the word says, you are my God and I'm your people. What about begin to pray in the spirit? Amen. Pray. Amen. When you can't even speak English. Amen. And the Holy Ghost takes over. And then all of a sudden coming to your mind, and God begins to quicken your spirit. And you begin to sing psalms and songs and spiritual songs. And you begin to preach to yourself. You begin to review the word in your spirit. And God quickens your mind. That's what they are there for. But I can't feel God. I prayed yesterday for 12.7 seconds. I watched the clock. Yeah. Pastor, I tried praying and I don't know how to pray. I don't know how to pray, to be honest. But when you can get in the spirit, you don't have to know anything. Hey, man, get in the spirit. Let the spirit take over. Because it's not always going to be easy peasy streets. There's going to be times if you haven't experienced this where you don't feel God. You feel dirty. You feel filthy. You feel unclean. Isaiah said himself, I'm a man of unclean lips. Why? Because he was drawn to the spirit. Yeah. And the closer you get to God, the worse you're going to feel. Why? Because you're in the presence of God. I will be your strength. I will be your hope. I'll be with you. Oh, even, everybody say even. Oh, you know, that should resonate with us better than anybody else. Reason with us, amen, that he will be with us to the end of the world. Not until Y2K or not until you feel God. No, right to the end.
Hallelujah.
Israel and Egypt, although real nations with real people, are also symbolic of the church and the world. Folks, I got to share something with you. You are the elect. I said you're the elect of God. You're God's people. We are in a strange land. We do not belong here. Amen. We don't fit in with this world. Amen. We're in the world, but we are not of this world. We're just a passing through. Things seem to be taxing the church. The world hates the church. The world is trying to give the church a difficult time. The world is trying to eradicate the church. Amen. They're not coming against the church as a body, but they want to eradicate your walk with God. Your family doesn't want you living for God. Your neighbors don't want you living for God. Your boss doesn't want you living for God. When you open your mouth, they want to shut you right up.
That's true.
Yeah. Amen. So, but we need to understand something. Amen. It's a word, amen, hiding. What the word is hiding behind the fear. What's going on in the world behind the fear? Amen. It fears the church, and the churches stand. They're fearful of the church. Did you know that? Just like Egypt, they weren't picking on the children of God because they're so strong. They began to fear them. And the world fears you. Well, why would they fear me? Because when you walk in their presence, there's something about, if you're living for God.
You stand for truth.
You stand for Almighty God. Now remember what we said earlier. If he abides in you, and you abide in him, what they're sensing is not you, but they're sensing the Spirit of God in you. And they don't like that because it causes them to feel convicted. Remember what it said about Isaiah coming by the Spirit? And he said, I'm a man of unclean lips. What does the world feel? Amen. If they step into the presence of God, oh, I am so dirty. And they might not feel that with you, but there's conviction. That's why it's so important that we live for God. Why? Because they've got to feel that conviction. You are sitting in the pew today. You're listening to this message today because God had put something in you and you felt conviction. That's what caused you to repent of your sins. That's what caused the early church on the day of Pentecost. Peter began to preach unto them. He didn't preach the weather. He didn't preach how nice the people looked or how kind they were or how thoughtful and please come to our society dance. No, he began to preach Jesus and how they crucified him. And you know what? The Jews did not crucify Jesus. Jesus went to the cross by himself. So it wasn't the Jews' fault for his crucifixion, but Peter used it. He said, you crucified. And all of a sudden, what happened? What happened to them? They were pricked in their hearts. They were convicted. Something was going on. They're seeing these people dancing in the Spirit and speaking in tongues. And they could not understand what they were saying. And these people walked up and said, what meaneth this? And Peter could have said, oh, this is no big. And to preach to them. Amen. And then conviction settled in. They were pricked in their heart. What shall we do? I'm not afraid when people get mad at me, amen, or they're not comfortable around me. I'm not afraid of that. You can't be afraid. You can't be everybody's friend. You've got to be, oh.
Hallelujah.
You've got to be their pastor.
Hallelujah.
Mm. What? Some of you have heard my voice when I try advising. Come on. And you didn't like it. Boy, it's not too many amens in here. Because I'm your pastor. You need to be somebody's pastor. You need to shepherd them into the presence of God. Don't worry about feeling conviction and people feeling conviction around you. Now, I'm going to preface that again with you've got to make sure you're living for God. Because if you're just acting, forgive this statement, if you're acting like an idiot, and they don't like you because of that, that's your ball game.
Yeah.
And forgive me for that statement, but it's so true. I've seen many people just act terrible, and they wonder why nobody wants to come to church. They don't like me. No, they don't like you because of you, not the Spirit. Mm. Make sure it's a conviction of God, not this.
Better than you attitude. That's right.
Ooh. Mm-hmm. Where am I?
Amen.
The world fears when the church does not conform to the world. Hey, the pressure of this life, I'm sorry to tell you, it's rough and it's going to get rougher. Sometimes things seem too hard to handle, too much to bear. Understanding involves too much to work to understand. But behind the scenes, I can't figure everything out. And please don't come to me and phone me or text me and say, oh, Pastor, this happened. What's the real purpose behind it? I don't know. But behind the scenes, God is preparing a Moses. Even some are getting ready to come to your help. Behind the scenes, the director of your life is rearranging some scenery. It's not the end yet.
That's right.
And behind the scenes, God is doing a work in your favor. You see, we limit God. Oh, God, you can only do this. We can't do that with you. He's got the qualifications to do anything he wants. He's got the strength. And you know what? He's got the wisdom that you don't have. I'm sorry, no offense. But he's got wisdom you ain't got. He's got the knowledge to do anything he wants. But until he does, we've got to remain abiding in him and having him abide in us. It would do the children of God no service if they weren't God's people in Egypt. There's some people that chose not to leave Egypt. They chose to stay. And if they want to stay, go right ahead and stay. But you know what? The church is going forward. There's people who want to remain in the world. They want the comforts of the world. They, even though it's a bad place, it's their conformity. It's their stability. They're not willing to change, not willing to trust God. They want to blend in with the world. They want to be in the world. They want to be of the world. And that's their choice. But as for me and my house, we are going to serve God. Hallelujah. Somebody say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
The children of Israel, they never quit. And when times got tough, they got tougher. That's what happened. They started to increase abundantly, and all these things took place. And then you read how the afflictions came, and they kept growing and kept growing. You know what, church? You don't have to whittle out. Amen. You can keep going and keep going and keep going. Amen. Even though the things come against us.
That's right.
Right after Peter and John spoke to the lame man at the gate beautiful and raised him to his feet, even by the power of the Holy Ghost. They preached to the onlooker, and the results were an overnight stay in prison. Acts chapter 4, verse 1. As they spake to the people, the priests and the captain of the temple and the Sadducees, they came on them, and being grieved that they taught the people, preached through Jesus the resurrection from the dead. And they laid hands on them and put them in hold until the next day, for it was now eventide. Howbeit, many of them which heard the word believed, and the number of the men was about 5,000 people. The results of their goodness. Wow, watch this. They're just being kind to the people. They saw a lame man. They healed him in the name of Jesus. Hey, they saw a need. There's a beggar on the street, and you know, he's been there, and silver and gold have I none, but such as I have. Give I thee in the name of Jesus, rise up and walk. That's all they did. Was that so awful? But it got them in prison. But God did not allow them to be in prison until those that witnessed the healing had heard the gospel also. Amen. Until the curious crowd received the invitation of the Spirit of God. And all this was the first persecution for the church. In 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 9, wherein I suffer trouble, even as an evildoer, even unto bonds, but the word of God is not bound. That's Paul. And you know what happened to Paul? Shipwrecked and starving and stoned and beaten and thrown off the wall and all that stuff. And he said, I was bound, but God is not bound. The word of God is not tied up. I might be. You might be suffering. Amen. But the word of God doesn't suffer. Philippians chapter 1, verse 12. But I would that you should understand, brethren, that the things that happened unto me have fallen out rather unto the furtherance of the gospel. He was telling them, you know all the stuff you heard on the newscasts and CBC and NBC and Twitter and Facebook, and all the bad things, the negative things you saw happen. Well, that did happen, but it was all for the furtherance of the kingdom. Now, how many want to go to jail? What? Nobody wants to go to jail. You know, I'm sure Peter and Paul and the other apostles, oh, can I go today? Can I go? No. Can I go to prison, please? Five thousand souls. Would you go to prison for 5,000 souls? Anybody? Would you go to, Dave, would you, I'm not, I shouldn't say, would anybody go to would go to jail if they knew 5,000 souls were walking to church because you went to jail overnight?
Oh, I think so.
Would you take a beating? Would you give your body to be punched and kicked and stoned and beaten until the inch of your life if you knew 5,000 souls were going to come in?
I think so.
I would hope we would, because there's 5,000 souls at stake. Now, here's the problem. They didn't know there's going to be 5,000 souls coming into the church, but they were willing. See, the process is here. The learning curve is here. This is the first persecution of the church, and the disciples and the apostles are all watching and waiting to see what was going to go on, and that encouraged them. I'm going to tell you how you can be encouraged in the Lord. Start trusting Him. Go through a hard time. Learn in your hard time. Something's going to go on. The world is not going to attack you if you're living like them. The devil's not going to chase you if you're going to live like him. But certainly he's going to start chasing you, amen, if you start living for God. He's not going to chase you if you just come to church and sit on the pew and you wonder, why is my life, it's just normal, nothing going on. Well, maybe you're living too normal to the world. Maybe start preaching. Oh, Pastor, I can't preach. Start opening your mouth and start being a witness. And you're going to invite some persecution. But you're going to learn in that persecution to trust in God.
That's right.
Amen, amen, amen. Is Pastor up here saying, you know, Dave, I'm going to pick on Dave again this morning. Sorry, Dave, you're such a defeated man up here, but you're better now. So now, David, I'm gonna throw you off the bus. I'm gonna push you or let you fall into the front of the bus to save a soul. Lord's not gonna do that tomorrow. But He might cause you to stub your toe today to learn a lesson. With child. And I'm just using analogies here. So if you stub your toe, I'm not saying it's of God. Pastor? I stubbed my toe today. What does it mean? I can hear the, I can see the songwriters writing. There's going to be a revival in the land. There's going to be a revival in the land. Three people stubbed their toes. There's going to be a revival in the land. Sometimes the Lord does things that are not so, He allows some things to happen, amen, that don't seem productive.
Yeah. Amen.
Amen. But the world, just like Egypt, they're afraid of the children of God. The children of God didn't understand that. They didn't see that. They didn't feel, oh, ooh, they're afraid of us. Oh, that's why they're doing this. No, they didn't know that. But what they did do is they continued to do what they knew to do. And they began to, in fact, they didn't just continue here. They started doing this and increasing because, hey, we don't know what's going on, but hey, let's, hey, folks, we don't understand what's going on in the end times, but let's have a good time. Let's put our hands together. Let's put our voices together. Hey, and we might be defeated in our flesh and tired in our flesh. We don't care about that. Put your hands together. Hey, and put your voices loud and shout the praises of God. Why? Because whatever happens, God knows about it, and He'll take care of us. Oh, God, you don't know where I've been. I certainly know where you've been. And start get on the bandwagon and get on the spiritual bandwagon and start being spiritual. Oh, and then everything's going to go hunky-dory. No, it's not. But you're going to be right with God. Watch this. The Bible, let me say the Bible, teaches that the latter rain is going to be greater than the former rain. That means whatever we read in the book of Acts is going to be multiplied in the day that we're living in the end times. We understand that, don't we?
Yeah.
People say, well, there's a great falling away. No, that's already taken place. But the latter rain is going to be greater than the former rain. And during the dark, what we call the dark ages, truth was lost. But so was the persecution.
Okay?
Because nothing's coming against the church because the church wasn't doing anything. That makes sense?
Yeah.
As the church gets closer and closer to pure truth. Everybody say pure truth.
Pure truth.
To pure truth. And that means that we begin to move in that truth. And that begins, we begin to move with God. We start getting godly, devoted. And we start doing what God has called us to do. Folks, that's going to open the door to something else that we don't like. It's called persecution. We all want. We will sing, shout, dance. We'll actually run the aisles. If we just started preaching, believing, and teaching that there's going to be a mighty revival and just going to take place, a whole city's going to come in and pastor's going to be so tired from baptizing people. It ain't going to happen like that. Because with a great revival, a great ingathering, comes great persecution. If the church, everybody say the church, desires to be an apostolic.
That's the key.
If the church desires to be an apostolic Book of Acts revival church, it's not pastor, it's the whole people. We need to have our eyes open. We need to be prepared. Amen. There's going to be a price to pay. There's going to be a cost to all this. We need to realize that if we want this type of revival that we see in our mind, that we are praying for, amen, there's also that much hindrance. I'm not trying to be a bearer of bad news. I'm just trying to tell us the truth. Amen. But when we realize this type of revival that we want and desire, and you might not want it, but I'm praying for this type of revival. But so does the persecution come. And so does the hand of the enemy come. But as Paul saw, in spite of that, there is a furtherance, amen, to the gospel of Jesus Christ. Like Paul said, amen, the things happened have fallen out rather into a furtherance of the gospel. In other words, what I went through, it's like I'm holding something and I'm being buffeted and I'm being challenged and I'm being troubled and I just can't hang on and it keeps going and I'm back here. My flesh is being beaten and tormented, but the furtherance of the gospel is going, still going ahead. You can not to stop the word of God. The devil, the world, may stop me. He may stop you. He may slow us up. He may trip us up. He may cause us to worry and fret. But the gospel of Jesus Christ must go forward. This is why it's so important. I may not feel him all the time. I may not sense him all the time. I may not even know God is there or not. But that doesn't matter. The Spirit of God, the furtherance of the kingdom of God, the word of God has to keep going. So it's not just I'm preaching, I'm talking. It's my lifestyle. It's my way of life. It's what I do. It's what I say. It's how I live. It's how I react. It's how I treat people. Amen. It's got to just keep forward. I'm going to be the same, like Jesus said. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Amen. That means that when I'm going through a hard time, I can't change my stance. I can't change the way I am. I can't change who I am. I've got to remain faithful to the cause. I can't get weary in well-doing and quit because I've ended failing.
Yeah.
And the world, and even in the church world, I understand. You went through a hard time. I understand why you quit. I understand why you backslid because somebody offended you. I understand because the world was attacking you. I understand why you didn't come. I'm sorry. I don't understand. I don't want to understand. Oh, pastor, you're just being a hardliner. Yeah? Somebody say amen.
Amen.
If that furtherance of the kingdom of God requires by default some negative effects, then we've got to be ready. as you know from our limited love, living for God, limited persecution, how down we get when we don't feel God. You got to get over it. Got to get over it. In all that Paul suffered in his ministry, listen to what he said to the Corinthians. He said, most gladly. He didn't write this before. He wrote this after. He said, most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, and the power of Christ may rest upon me. We all want to feel the power of God shaking and quaking us and set our feet to dance and then rejoicing and being exceeding. We love that. But Paul said this. He said, I would rather glory in my infirmities. Oh, God, I don't feel you, but thank God I'm living for you and I don't feel you. But you know what, God, I trust you. Oh, thank you, Lord, for allowing me to go through the persecution. Thank you for Dave being mad at me today and upset at me. Thank you for Dave calling me and texting me saying he hates me. Thank you, Lord, for that, because I preached to him the word of God. Thank you for my neighbors not being happy with me because they hear me preaching through the window. Amen. Thank you, Lord, for the persecution that I feel today because, Lord, I know I'm living for God. I am not saying, and again, remember that preface, you've got to be living for him first. I quoted something a couple weeks ago. I'm going to quote it better today because I remember what the person said. They said this, the world treats us like scum, but scum rises to the top. That's okay. That's okay if you're living for God, but they weren't. They were treating people like scum. They were. Physically. And they're treating people bad, and so that's the report they got back. But if I'm living for God, if I'm serving God to the best of my ability, as the Word says, and the world treats me bad, then I'm going to stand and I'm going to glory in my persecution. Because the kingdom of God is going forward. I might be at a standstill. I may be in a pause of life and I can't feel God. I can't sense God. I may not feel like dancing. I may not feel like putting my hands together. But God doesn't say, the Word does not say when you feel like it. And you've heard me say this how many times now? That song, I feel like praising Him. Throw it out the window. Praise Him in the morning. Praise Him in the afternoon. Praise Him in the evening. Whether you feel like it or not. Whether everything's going your way or not. Whether you're tired or not. Whether you're sore or not. Praise Him anyways. Because what you're going through doesn't determine what He's worth. If we want that apostolic revival, we got to pull up our socks. Peter and John suffered. Paul suffered. The apostles suffered. Oh, but Pastor, we're not going to suffer. There's going to be licorice and popsicles coming our way. Are we ready to pay the price? Are we willing to keep our eyes focused on Jesus? Are we willing to keep our minds, amen, centered at the goal? Are we willing to keep the distractions in the background? See, a lot of times things come our way not to get us to sin, but to distract us. Get caught up in something. See, the world, the devil is wise. He's smart. I'm not giving him credit. He doesn't have to come and grab your feet and trip you up. He puts something over here that you just love. He'll dangle it. And he'll get your eyes looking here. And the Lord is saying, look on me. But this looks so good. But Lord, you don't understand this person here, what they mean to me. You don't understand, Pastor, you don't understand that this person, you know, that they're my friend. And you know, they want me to come here today. And I can't come to church. You notice? You go to pray and your phone rings. And it's your best friend. You set a time. I'm going to go and do this. And all of a sudden, you got to go to work. Whatever it is, it's not sin. Distractions. Distractions, that's all they are. Keep your eyes on Jesus. Willing to keep the distractions at bay. Even when you don't hear God. Well, the Lord never told me that. It doesn't happen. Even when you don't feel God. Have you ever felt what you thought was God and it wasn't God?
Yeah.
That's why we need to be discerning spirit. That's why we need to search the scripture. That's why we need to be sensitive to the Holy Ghost. Because not every spirit is of God. Not every word is of God. Not every spirit's of God. And not every pause from God means it's bad. It's a learning. It's a time of learning. But God, and you know how many times I've heard this? Lord, I don't see you moving in our church. You know how many times I've heard? I'm leaving because I don't see God moving in our church. Maybe God is moving. And you're moving. See, you don't have to see. That's a Gentile mindset of worry about what you're going to eat today and what you're going to put on tomorrow. And Jesus said, take no thought for this. You're the Gentiles, but you've been converted to Christianity. Put your trust in Jesus, whether you